Agile methodologies can be a great way to run a project, keeping the team engaged, producing great results, and making everybody happy and productive. On the other hand, it can also be a very wasteful way to proceed, depending on how you do it, with awful results, very low productivity, producing almost nothing, and with some people being convinced that you're producing nothing at all, period. So how do you go about using Agile in a way that's going to be productive for your team? Hi, I'm John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I spent the last 30 years working in software industry, mostly in big tech, and the last 10 years working almost exclusively with Agile methodologies in the various projects I worked in, ranging from hundreds of people in a project to just a couple. Over that time at Microsoft, Google, and Amazon, I learned quite a bit about what I thought would work well for Agile, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. This video is not an Agile tutorial. You have to understand how the Agile methodologies work and the various options and terminology for it in order for this video to make any sense at all. What it is instead is a set of recommendations out of the various choices you have for Agile of what worked best for me in the groups I was in and maybe a few things that didn't work so well. For the rest of this video, we're going to talk about two basic categories of advice. The first is tools, and the second is the processes that you follow while you're doing Agile. In terms of tools, you have two basic options. The first is to use manually written tools, for example, a whiteboard and a set of drawn swim lanes, and a bunch of items written down on note cards or on sticky notes that move along there. The second option is to use some sort of software to let you track items and integrate with the rest of your processes. Frankly, I've seen both of these approaches work quite well. Personally, I prefer the software-driven approaches because I find it integrates more easily with all the other work that I have to do at a company, and it also works much better with a geographically distributed group. When somebody has to be home because of a kid or they're sick, or if they just happen to be somewhere else, it's much easier to ensure that they can see the board and the tasks and everything else having to do with that work. The two software packages that I've used for Agile are Microsoft Visual Studio Team Foundation Services and Atlassian Jira. Both of them work really well. They both have their own strengths, and really either one will help you move your process along quite well. So when you're picking a package, you can try out either of those, or if you already have some bug tracking and so on in place, pick the one that integrates best with what you're using. When you're figuring out how to track your work items from the very small to the very large, I recommend using tasks, stories, and epics. Tasks are small work items, usually between 1 and 4 days. You can make them bigger if you want to, but I've had the best results with ones that fit inside of a week. A story is a set of tasks that work together to make something happen. And finally, an epic is a set of stories that describe a bigger item. A task might be something small like add a go button and plumb it in to the configuration page. A story might be create the configuration page for our product. And then an epic might be something like create all of the UI for our project. As I said, a task tends to be smaller than a week. A story will fit within a sprint, but not necessarily within a week, and usually consists of multiple tasks. And an epic is usually multiple sprints with a whole bunch of stories. It could be something that lasts for months or even for years. Work items which aren't being worked on in the current sprint are usually stored in something called the backlog. Now, my preference is to have a backlog which includes all of the work the team has to do, sorted in order from highest priority to lowest priority. That way, when you're ready to add stuff to the backlog or ready to take things from it and put it in a sprint, it's situated in a way that makes it much easier for you to do those things. For all of your tasks, there are certain fields that you should have to track what's going on in them. You should have an estimate of how much work there is total in the task, how much work is remaining to be done, how much work has been done so far. You should have a pithy title for the task. The person who created the task should be easily available, and the person who it's assigned to. You also want to be able to have the status of the task, whether it's pending or actively being worked on or completed. If the task belongs to a story, then the task should be linked to that story, just like a story should be linked to any epic that contains it. Now, you're welcome to add other information to tasks if you want to, but these are the fields that I've always found to be useful. There's literally hundreds of other options. Be careful about how much you put there, bearing in mind that somebody is probably going to have to fill it out for each task they create. The toolset you use for tracking a sprint should make it easy for you to keep track of the capacity of the team. In other words, how much work can be done in a sprint. It should also make it easy for you to track how far along you are and to see the burndown rate. In other words, how quickly you're making progress against all the work in a given sprint. It can also be very useful for the software tool to have a way for you to provide a theme for a sprint and to provide notes about that sprint. For example, at the post-mortem or the wrap-up, to say what was accomplished, what the goals were, and to keep notes for the future. And that's pretty much it for the tools and the basic configuration for Agile. Now let's talk a little bit about the processes that you follow when you're working on sprints and overall for Agile. Sprint durations of either 2 or 3 weeks worked best for me in the various projects I was in. I did try them shorter and longer, but 2 to 3 weeks seemed to be the best compromise between the overhead associated with the sprint and being able to predict how much work you could fit into it and being able to have a nice goal without losing track of things. It usually worked best for the sprints to start on a Monday and end on a Friday, but it doesn't have to be that way. Even though I did that in most of my teams, a couple of them I had sprints that started on a Wednesday and ended on a Tuesday. This was a little hard to align with the rest of our status processes, but it did allow you to have a clean handoff between the end of a sprint and the start of the next sprint without having a weekend in between. Finally, if you're part of a larger set of teams working together, then it can be very useful to have all the teams start their sprint on the same day and have the same sprint duration and the same nomenclature for what the sprints are named, like June.1. Now, it's not required. You can be functional without this, but I've found that having everybody use the same nomenclature and the same sprint times and lengths allows you to more easily coordinate activities and dependencies between these various teams, which you're going to have to do sooner or later. Sprints worked best for my teams with 4 different processes. Initial planning, daily scrums, the demo and sprint completion, and then a post-mortem at the end of it. At the start of a sprint, the team should get together to have a sprint planning meeting. This is where you all get together in a room, usually for a couple hours, and pick the tasks that are going to be part of the next sprint. The first thing you do in planning is scrub the backlog. This can be done by the scrum master or it can be done by the team as a whole. You take a look at the items, make sure they all make sense, and then make sure that they're sorted in priority order from the most important to the least important. That will allow you to go from top to bottom when you are picking the items for the next sprint. The next thing that you should do is pick a theme for the sprint. It's not strictly required, but it's very helpful to have a theme, something like light up the initial UI or fix all of our outstanding operations bugs. Take a look at the top several items in your backlog and see if a theme emerges from that. If not, talk to folks and think about slightly reprioritizing things so that most of the work fits together in a theme. This is good both for producing something that's visible and for the morale of the team as a whole working together. Next, you want to actually take a look and start making estimates based on the work items that are at the top of your backlog. You should do about 50% more than the capacity of your team in terms of coming up with the estimates. The way that we did estimates in our teams was something called planning poker. So for each item, the person who wrote up that item would explain what it was, and then everybody would vote on whether they thought it was going to be, for example, 1 day, 2 days, 4 days, or 8 days. Any items that were too big, we would divide up into further items. Generally, we use the consensus number as what the length of the work item would be, but if there was one person who was really an expert on it, we would also take their word for it with just a sanity check. As you're estimating capacity, I always started with less than an 8-hour workday for the capacity. So for example, for individual contributors, I would say they had a 6-hour day. This is to make room for things like the occasional meeting or email, questions from other people, mentoring, whatever else they have going on. And in fact, capacity can be lower than that. Let's say that you have somebody who's commonly called upon by other teams to help with interviewing or to audit their designs and stuff. Instead of having 5 days worth of capacity from them per week, you might have 3 days or 2 days. This is something you should take into the initial plan for each sprint. After you've picked these items and moved them into the sprint, then you're ready to start with your regular Scrum process day by day until the sprint is completed. A Scrum is a daily meeting between all the people participating in that particular sprint in that team. They get together for anywhere from 5 to 15 minutes, talk about their progress for the day briefly, and then disband. Now, you really want to be disciplined about your Scrum meetings. It's easy for these to devolve into hour-long meetings. What I recommend you do is very quickly get status from each person. If any issues come up that take longer than 15 or 30 seconds, you say, post-scrum, and you write it down on a note. Then at the end of the scheduled scrum, which is usually fairly short, anybody who doesn't need to stick around for post-scrum issues can go ahead and take off. For post-scrum, you can break up into groups of people who are talking about the various issues, or you can all go over them together, whoever decided to stay. The key thing is, during scrum, all the teams should be there for scrum, and during post-scrum, only the people who need to be there should be there. In terms of timing, I've found that scrum works best to have at the very beginning of the day. Now, this can be difficult in teams where people are allowed to start at different times. For example, in the teams I've been in, I usually start quite early, 5 or 6 in the morning, and other people on the team might not start until 11 a.m. In those cases, you really want to have everybody at the meeting without any excuses, and so you set a time that matches the time of the day starting for the person who gets up the latest. Now, that's not to say that Scrum has to be at the very beginning of the day. There's nothing that says it can't be at the middle or the end of the day. End works okay. For me personally, I found it worked best to be in the morning where I would have a chance to act on anything that I learned in that Scrum. For example, if somebody needed help getting unblocked, if there were problems that had cropped up, and so on. After you've made it through the couple weeks of the sprint, then it's time to do your sprint completion and the demo. Now, we usually schedule a meeting for this, an hour or two meeting. The demo itself, you would identify a week or two ahead of time who was going to give a demo. Didn't have to be everybody, but you wanted to have one or two interesting demos. The demo itself, it could be something as straightforward as showing a UI they made, or if it's something deeper in the product, you might have to use a test tool to show it or show that a service started running in some operating system component. Ultimately, it doesn't have to be anything pretty, but you want it to be something that demonstrates, yes, there's a difference between when we started the sprint and where we are right now. Also, if you have customers or customer advocates, you want them to see the demo as well, so they can give feedback, oh, that's so wonderful, or, oh, you know, actually, this isn't quite what we were thinking of. Let's change it for the next sprint. For the formal sprint completion, this is something that can be done by the team, or it can just be done by the Scrum Master, who will take a look and click the buttons that you need to do to move the items out of that sprint and total up all the numbers to make them ready for the post-mortem. Typically, you would do this on the same day as the demo. It doesn't have to be, but typically you would. And then it's really up to you whether you want to do the post-mortem on the same day as the demo or on the day that follows it. Our post-mortems were typically a half hour or an hour involving the entire team. People would get together and you would talk about what went well or what could have gone better. You'd take a look at your process and make sure it still made sense to follow. You'd adjust any plans that you had to make. And you would also maybe take a look and make sure the project itself is going the right direction. This is also the time that you would pull out a couple of different charts. The ones that I found especially useful were the ones that showed how much work was outstanding day by day in the sprint. And that would show if you were actually adding work rather than completing things, and also how much work was completed, and hopefully a burn down that shows, hey, look, we did a good job of predicting how much work there was to do and sticking to our schedule and finishing most everything at the end. Now, ideally, you want to have a little bit of work left over. That says that nobody was sitting there starved for work and just sort of idling, but you want to be relatively close to the capacity for the team. So in summary, Agile is a great way to manage projects, and it's fairly universal these days. I've given you some tips of ways that you can both choose the way that you're going to run the sprints and the different parts, starting the sprint, executing day by day, and then taking a look at the results and sort of course correcting to move forward. If you have done a fair amount of Agile and you have ideas about what works or doesn't work, I'd love to hear about them. If you think some of the things I'm saying don't make any sense, I'd love to hear that too. So go ahead and leave comments down below. Also, if you found this content useful or entertaining, then please think about leaving us a like and subscribing so that I know what type of content to keep producing for the future. Well, thanks for making it this far, and keep on pushing forward.